Good morning. I am Master Sergeant Jennifer Shelley, and I will be your Master of Ceremonies for today's program. It is my pleasure to welcome you to the 2013 Team Minot National Prayer Luncheon. Please take a moment to silence your cell phones. Thank you. Please stand for the singing of the National Anthem by Airman First Class Haley Kreider and the invocation by Chaplain Williams.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, oh, the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the
Thank you, Airman Kreider. Chaplain Williams, will you please come forward to offer the invocation and opening remarks?
If you're willing, would you pray with me? Almighty God, help us to pause for a few moments this morning to realize our need for your help in our lives. We pray that you will bless our Minot team, commanders, officers, NCOs, airmen and civilian that work so hard to accomplish the mission. We pray, too, for our dependents and family members. Grant us all success and safety in our mission from day to day. Lord, we especially want to remember all of our brothers and sisters who are deployed around the world and can't be with us today. Watch over them, we ask. Give them your protection and assure them of success. And now as we turn our focus to this event, we pray that the food and the word provided for us will bless and strengthen our bodies and spirits. In your holy name we pray, amen. You may be seated. On behalf of Colonel Mazinski and the entire chapel team, I'd like to personally welcome each and every one of you to our annual prayer luncheon. Special welcome to our guest speaker, Chaplain Richardson. Sir, it's a delight to have you here with us today. We look forward to hearing you speak. For many years, we have used this occasion to remember the moral and spiritual values on which our nation is founded, as well as focus on our own spiritual fitness. We have a great many things to be thankful for. Our heritage, our freedom and our history as a people who recognize God's leading and blessings in our lives. So welcome everyone, and please enjoy this time of prayer and fellowship.
Thank you, Chaplain Williams. There are a number of special guests here today that we would like to recognize. The distinguished members of the head table include Commander, 5th Bomb Wing, Colonel Alex Mazinski and his spouse, Jennifer. Commander, 91st Missile Wing, Colonel Rob Fircher and his spouse, Amy. Spouse of the Vice Commander, 5th Bomb Wing, Miss Kim Mitchell. Vice Commander, 91st Missile Wing, Colonel Tom Summers and his spouse, Nancy. Command Chief, 5th Bomb Wing, Chief Kevin Turgella and his spouse, Barb Faulkner. And former Air Force Chief of Chaplains and today's guest speaker, Chaplain Major General Cecil Richards, United States Air Force, retired.
Hey, how are you?
We would also like to welcome all group and squadron commanders, honorary commanders, chiefs, first sergeants, and our family and friends who have joined us today. As you entered the dining area this morning, you may have noticed a table at the front, raised to call your attention to its purpose. It is reserved to honor our missing loved ones, set for 6. The empty places represent Americans still missing from each of the 5 services: Army, Marine Corps, Navy, Air Force, Coast Guard, and civilians. This honors ceremony symbolizes that they are with us here in spirit. Some in this room were very young when they went into combat. However, all Americans should never forget the brave men and women who answered our nation's call and served the cause of freedom in a special way. I would like to ask you to stand and remain standing for a moment of silent prayer as the Honor Guard places the 5 service covers and civilian cap on each of the empty plates. Please be seated. I would like to explain the meaning of the items on this special table. The table is round to show our everlasting concern for our missing men and women. The tablecloth is white, symbolizing the purity of their motives when answering the call to duty. The single red rose displayed in a vase reminds us of the life of each of the missing and the loved ones and friends of these Americans who keep the faith awaiting answers. The vase is tied with a yellow ribbon, a symbol of our continued determination to account for our missing. A slice of lemon on the bread plate is to remind us of their bitter fate of those captured and missing in a foreign land. A pinch of salt symbolizes the tears endured by those missing and their families who seek answers. The glass is inverted to symbolize their inability to share today's toast. The chair is empty. They are not here. Ladies and gentlemen, please charge your glasses with water. Let us now stand and raise our water glasses in a silent toast to honor America's POWs and MIAs. Thank you. Please be seated.
As we prepare to pray for our nation, we direct your attention to the screen. The video screen to my left. Almighty God, we thank you for America and for the virtues of democracy, virtues which ensure liberty and justice throughout the land. Our nation is one blessed with freedom and hope. Bless our nation with honest industry, truthful education, and an honorable way of life. We humbly pray that we may always remember your generosity and faithfully do your will. Guide us in our efforts to live in peace. We pray for your guidance as we work together for the best interests of our communities, our nation, our world, and the ultimate goal of peace. When times are prosperous, let our hearts be thankful, and in troubled times, may our deepest trust be in you. Increase our love for our country, that we may guard it as a trust. God, we come as people who remember your covenant, who are willing to love you and one another, people journeying to meet you in fasting, prayer, and almsgiving. Let our hearts and our actions always remain well and pleasing in your sight. Be with President Obama, members of the Congress and Senate. Watch over our military commanders, airmen, Coast Guardsmen, Marines, soldiers, and sailors. Especially, we ask your protection upon those who even now stand in harm's way, on foreign soil engaged in battle. Look upon our nation's families, strengthen our communities, bless us and keep us. Amen.
This is from the Hebrew scriptures out of Kings 18, also called Melachim Aleph Shmona Asar. Then said Eliyahu unto Ha'am, I, even I only, am left a Navi of Hashem, but Baal's Nevi'im are 450-ish. Let them therefore give us 2 parim, and let them choose 1 bull for themselves, and cut it into pieces, and lay it on the wood, and put no ash under it. And I will dress the other bull, and lay it on the wood, and put no ash under it. And call ye on the Shem Elohim, and I will call on the Shem of Hashem. And Ha'elohim that answereth by Aish, let him be Ha'elohim. And Kol Ha'am answered and said, Tov Hadavar. And Eliyahu said unto the Nevi'im of Baal, choose you 1 bull for yourselves, and dress it first. For ye are Rabbim, and call on the Shem Elohim, but put no ash under it. And they took the bull which was given them, and they dressed it, and called on the Shem of Baal from Boker even until Zorahim, saying, Baal, answer us. But there was no voice, and no one answered. And they danced around the Mizbaach which had been made. And it came to pass at Zorahim that Eliyahu mocked them, taunting, saying, shout with Kol Gadol, for he is a god. Either he is meditating or he is pursuing. Or Kiderech Lo, he is relieving him. Or perhaps he sleepeth and must be awakened. And they shouted with Kol Gadol, and cut themselves after their mishpat and charavot and lances, till the dam gushed out upon them. And it came to pass when Zorahim was passed, and they prophesied until the time of the offering of the mincha. And there was neither kol, nor one, nor any attender. And Eliyahu said unto Kol Ha'am, come near unto me. And Kol Ha'am came near unto him. And he repaired the Mizbaach Hashem that was in ruins. And Eliyahu took 12 avanim, according to the mispar of the Shifti B'nai Yaakov, unto whom the Devar Hashem came, saying, Yisrael shall be Shemacha. And with the Avanim, he built a Mizbaach in the Shem of Hashem. And he made a Ta'ala around the Mizbaach as a space of 2 seas of Zerah. And he laid the wood in order and cut up the bowl and laid it on the wood and said, fill four jugs with ma'in and pour it on the olah and on the wood. And Eliyahu said, do it the second time. And they did it the second time. And he said, do it the third time. And they did it the third time. And the ma'in ran around about the mizbaach and even filled the tala also with ma'in. And it came to pass at the time of the offering of the mincha that Eliyahu HaNavi'i came near and said, Hashem Elohi Abraham Yitzchak and of Israel, let it be known this day that thou art Elohim in Israel, and that I am thy Eved, and that I have done all these things at thy Davar. Answer me, Hashem, answer me, that Ha'am Hazeh may know that thou art Hashem Elohim, and that thou hast turned their back, turned back their lev. Then the Aish of Hashem fell and consumed the olah and the wood, and the avanim, and the afar, and licked up the ma'im that was in the ta'ala. And when Kol Ha'am saw it, they fell on their faces, and they said, Hashem hu ha'Elohim, Hashem hu ha'Elohim.
Today's Christian reading will be coming from 1 Corinthians chapter 13. If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, if I have a faith that can move mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and surrender my body to the flames, but have no love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It is not rude. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoice with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. But where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when perfection comes, the imperfect disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put childish ways behind me. Now we see but a poor reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part. Then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love.
Good afternoon. Today's Islamic reading comes from the introduction of the Quran. It's called Al-Fatiha. It is the very first surah of the Quran and probably considered the most important because of its meaning. It represents the relationship between man and God, because Muslim itself means servant. So it reminds the servant, the Muslim, of his relationship between God. His will is to serve. I will read it first in Arabic, since Arabic is the true form of the religion. It's the language of paradise in Islam. So I'll read it in that language first, and then I will translate it in the English. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawm Ad-Din, Iyaka Na'budu wa Iyaka Nasta'in, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. That basically means, in the name of God, most gracious, most merciful, praise be to Allah, God, the cherisher and sustainer of the worlds, most gracious and most merciful, master of the day of judgment. Thee do we worship and thy aid do we seek. Show us the straight path, the straight way, the way of those on whom has bestowed thy grace, those whose portion is not wrath and who go not astray. That's the meaning of the Al-Fatiha. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Airman Chitral, Sergeant Godfrey, and Airman Cox. Ladies and gentlemen, Chaplain Johnson.
Hello, Team Minot. That's weak. Hello, Team Minot.
Hello, sir.
That's good. You're not asleep. Good lunch. You're staying awake. I'm the icebreaker for our guest speaker today, so I'm glad you're awake. Glad you're listening. How's lunch?
Good.
How was lunch?
Good, sir.
$5, you can't beat it, can you? Pretty good. Yeah. Well, I am so excited that you are here. Thank you so much for coming today. I guess you could have been in your cubicle checking email or out and about doing something else, but you are here with us, and I guarantee you, you're going to have a blessed time today. I do want to start by thanking two individuals, Major General Thomas and Lieutenant General Kowalski, our commanders at Global Strike Command. They actually funded today's program because they really believe in it, and they realize that money is tight, but the word I saw, the word I heard was make it happen. So a special thanks to Global Strike for this. We are so fortunate to be in our ABUs today because our guest speaker wanted to be in service dress because he thinks he's better looking in service dress. I thought, well, wait a minute. You can't be the guest speaker and be better looking than both of us, so he compromised, so it's good. It was a hot summer day in 1997. I had just walked out of the chapel walking down the sidewalk. And there was this full colonel walking my way. I rendered proper salute, got about two steps, and he called me back. And we've been friends ever since then. So it's just been a wonderful relationship. He reached out his hand and said, Cecil Richardson. So he's known as Cecil Richardson, but to me, he's known as the boss. He's a great guy, but that's just the way he carries himself. His wife, Jan, has a PhD education. She is a prolific writer. She's an author. She's an international speaker, but she does all this to support his bow hunting addiction. And it's true. He started his Air Force career as an enlisted airman to eventually become a general officer. He is without question one of the best speakers the Air Force has ever produced that you will ever hear. He has a great sense of humor, extremely captivating, and he's here to meet you wherever you may be today. So please give a warm Team Minot welcome for Chaplain Major General Richardson.
Shy person, and it's always a little embarrassing when somebody introduces me and says all those things, and you have to live up to it. And I don't know how in the world God made me the chief of chaplains as shy as I am, but he just said, okay, Cecil, you're it. Boys in the back of the old Suburban, and we got our camping gear together and put some food in there, and we took off to, if you've been stationed there, Hamas Springs. We took off to Hamas Springs. Oh, yeah, you know it.
And we went up there and we unloaded and we started playing frisbee and stuff. And we were just having a good old time. And then it got a little cold and a little bit of snow started floating out of the sky. And I thought, wow, that'd be neat. The kids will see a little snow. Well, if you've ever been, you've been there. There's no such thing as a little snow in the mountains of New Mexico. It went whoosh. I mean, suddenly there was 2 or 3 inches of snow and it was coming down heavy and wet. And I thought, oh no, I'll never get out of here. So we threw the gear in the old Suburban in the back of it. I put the boys in there. I threw it in gear and lunged forward and made it about 3 or 4 inches. And I started rocking back and forth on the wet leaves and this heavy, wet snow. And it kept coming down and I could not move at all. I was hopelessly stuck. So I unloaded the boys again, and I thought, well, we'll build a fire, and we'll have some supper. Well, the wood was all soaking wet, and I couldn't get a fire. So I brought the boys back into the back of the Suburban, and we sat there, and I fed them cold hot dogs and pork and beans. And as we sat there, kind of cold, wrapping ourselves up in our sleeping bags, miserable, wondering what in the world we're going to do now. We can't go outside and play. One of the boys got sick. I mean, like projectile sick, like forgive my expressions, but all over the sleeping bags and all over us. And then the other two boys got sick the same way. And I'm sitting back there in the back of the truck thinking, oh no, here I am. I've got my little boys out here in the woods. We're freezing to death. We can't stand the stench. There's no place to sleep. And I go, what do we do? What do we do? And my little 8-year-old, who is today himself a chaplain, he turned to me and he said, Daddy, shouldn't we pray? I'm the chaplain. I should have thought of that. But I wasn't feeling very spiritual right then, and so I said, Steve, why don't you pray? Well, I will never, ever, ever, for the rest of my life and through all of eternity, forget what my little boy prayed that day. For he bowed his little head, and he said, Dear God, please send us a 4-wheel drive Chevrolet truck to pull us out of the snow. Here's my Bible. It wasn't 3 minutes before a 4-wheel drive Chevrolet truck with chains, teenagers, and firewood came flying through the woods. They pulled up right beside us and they said, Hey, you need some help? I said, Well, yeah. You know, can you pull us out of the snow? Oh, yeah. They hooked onto us and pulled us right on out. I mentioned I'd never forget it, but more important than that, my boys have never forgotten it. And all three of them today are serving the Lord. How do we pray? We pray first by honoring God. Hallowed be thy name. Then we pray by giving the glory to God to make sure that everybody understands, ourselves included, that this is God. And thirdly, we pray by counting the odds and making our decision for the Lord. Elijah counted the odds. He evaluated the situation. See, it was not a popular time to be religious. Just like today, it's not that popular. There were 450 prophets of Baal. There was one prophet of God. The prophets of Baal were praying on a dry sacrifice. The prophet of God was praying on a wet sacrifice. The prophets of Baal prayed from morning all the way into evening. The prophet of God prayed 63 words. That's all he prayed. But there was one big difference. Prophets of Baal were praying to a piece of stone, and the prophet of God was praying to the living Lord of heaven and earth. When Elijah prayed, there was no dancing around or cutting himself or working himself into frenzy. He simply called on God and said, Dear God, please let them know that you are Lord and I am your prophet. Send fire upon this altar that people might know that you are God and their hearts will be turned back to you. And the Bible says the fire of God fell. And it didn't just fall on the little area. It fell on the sacrifice, on the wood, and it licked up all the water, even in the trench. And after just a second, there was nothing left but a greasy spot and some steam. And all the people did exactly what you and I would have done. They fell flat on their faces, and they cried out, The Lord, He is God. The Lord, He is God. As a chaplain, I want you to know that there really is a God in heaven, a God who loves you, and a God who hears and answers prayer. How do you pray? You pray by honoring God. You pray by giving Him the glory. You pray by making your decision for the Lord and deciding against all opposition. You're going to follow the Lord and then praying in faith, believing. Now, I know what I'm talking about. This is not just theory for me. I didn't start out as a general. I started out as a one-striper like many of you did. I was raised in the poorest of Appalachia. My father was severely handicapped, a coal miner. Most of my family couldn't read or write. They were all alcoholics, all my uncles, both my grandfathers and my father. My father was a violent man. He used to pick me up by the hair of the head and beat me until my face was so swollen I could go to school and couldn't read the board. He had a hard fist and I had a soft face. They say if you kick a kid, he'll grow up mean, and I'm a testimony to that fact because I grew up mean. I had no spiritual foundation. I had never been in church. The day that I turned 18, I did what was expected of me as a young man, 18 years old. I tucked $3 in my pocket. I put some underwear in a brown paper bag. I walked out to the driveway, stuck my thumb out, and never returned. I hitchhiked from place to place, sleeping in park benches and under trees, and I finally landed up in Rockford, Illinois, got a job at J.I.K.'s Tractor Company, and I figured for the rest of my life I would work in a factory like some of my family did. After about 6-7 months in the factory, I got a letter from my uncle, Uncle Samuel. He was having a little war in Vietnam. He wanted me to come join him. And I got drafted. To avoid going in the Army and just running up and down hills, I decided I would join the Air Force. One of the best decisions ever made in my life. But I wish I could tell you, for the sake of the first sergeants in the room, I wish I could tell you that the Air Force straightened me out. Well, it was not meant to be. I was a first sergeant's nightmare, letter of reprimand, letter of counseling. I was always in fights, always running from the police even then. I got in a fight one time in a barracks and threw a guy out a third floor window, and the only reason that I didn't go to jail is that he was a bigger criminal than I was. I got in another fight in the dorms, and we fell into a guy's room when he was ironing his clothes. I grabbed the iron and ironed this guy, and to this day he's scarred up from my having ironed him. I was that kind of guy. I was a good interpreter, and they needed interpreters. I was good with languages and still am, but I was a rotten airman. One day down at San Angelo, Texas, Goodfellow Air Force Base, I was going through a transliteration school and I was trying to meet girls. I was just doing everything I could to meet girls. I tried bars and parties and all those kind of things, and I couldn't meet any girls. And I finally said, "Hey, Cecil, why don't you go to a church? I bet there's lots of girls in church." And I'd never been in church. I didn't know. I walked off base. There was one. I started walking into it, and I thought, no, I don't want to pay for this thing. And so I sneaked around the back so I wouldn't have to pay at the door. And I just sat in the church looking for girls, and there was an old white-haired guy up front talking. And after a while, I started listening to him, and I thought, man, if that guy is right and the things he's saying, I'm in a heap of trouble. And the longer he talked, the more I realized he's right. And then something happened to Cecil Richardson. The pastor said, if you want to get your heart right with God, step out of that pew and come down here and kneel at this altar. There was an old lady to my left. Remember, I was a rough guy. I turned to her and pushed her. I said, "Get away." And I rushed down to the front and I fell on my knees. And I wish I could tell you what I prayed. I wish it was some awesome. No, I just poured my heart out. And I said, "God, if ever anybody needs you, I need you. Lord, can you change my life? Can you change me?" And right there at that altar, the fire of God fell on my life. And God changed me. He didn't take away my shyness. He didn't take away all my weaknesses. He took those few little strengths that I had, and he channeled them for his glory. I think I have time for one more story, and then I'll quit. It's one that I've told all these years. Shame on me if I quit telling it. 2 years later, I was a senior airman and preparing to get out of the Air Force. I was at Fort Meade as an Air Force guy in Maryland. I was working 95 hours, 40 hours for the Air Force, 55 hours for a gas station, saving all my money to get out of the Air Force. I was engaged to a girl that sang alto and played piano, and that's what I was told I needed, so I'd found one. My application was in for a 3-month early out. I was going to get out of the Air Force in spring semester. I was going to go to college, get a degree in biblical studies, get a master's degree in Hebrew, get a PhD in archaeology. I was going to pastor a church, teach seminary, and do archaeological excavations on the side, sort of an Indiana Cecil. I had it all worked out. And suddenly, my whole life fell apart. It started when somebody broke into the barracks, the Army barracks where I was living, and they took everything I owned. And stupidly, I had been cashing all my checks, both from the gas station and the Air Force, and putting the money in my locker and just locking the locker. Well, when I came back, the locker was gone, and everything else was gone too. The very next day, I got a Dear Cecil letter from the girl I was engaged to. She felt like she was going to become a missionary to India, and she knew that wasn't the way I was going, and she was right, but I was devastated. That same day, Russia invaded Czechoslovakia. I was a Russian interpreter. I had to quit my gas station job and go to work 16 hours a day monitoring the Russians in Czechoslovakia. Then I got a notice from the Air Force saying that they were ending their early out program. I had to be accepted to college by the 15th of December in order to be able to get out of the Air Force for the spring semester, and I was nowhere close to being accepted. Then I got a letter from the college that I had applied to saying, should you be accepted, you will need to bring these things, you know, sheets and towels and blankets and umbrella and all that kind of stuff. And I didn't have any of that stuff. The worst thing of all is I couldn't pray. I just couldn't. It seemed like God was 10,000 miles away in a Model T Ford, broken out of gas and totally unconcerned about little Cecil, and I just couldn't pray. And one day it got so bad that I went out, some of you know Fort Meade, there's a big area where they used to train tanks. I went out to the big open area, and it was a muddy, wet day. I pushed my way through the forest, and I knelt down in the woods and in the mud, and I put my head between my knees, and I cried to God, and I said, God, I thought you were calling me to the ministry, but now my whole life is falling apart. What in the world do I do? Oh, God, please help me. And I got up, and I walked back through the woods and came up on the pavement, and as soon as I stepped on the pavement, I was arrested for murder. They had found a woman about a mile away. She had been killed violently. And they realized right away I wasn't the one, but they saw me covered with mud and all this stuff, and they, but you talk about discouraged, I was discouraged. They set me loose immediately, but I was discouraged. Just a few days later, I decided I was gonna run home before anything else went bad, because things had gone so bad at work, that I ran back to the barracks, I ran up the stairs, hit my hand on a radiator, and broke a blood vessel and had to be taken to the hospital. That same day, I pulled out an 8.5 by 11 sheet of paper that I still have. And I wrote on the sheet of paper everything that I needed in order to go to college. I wrote down that I needed acceptance to college by the 15th of December in order to go and be a minister. I wrote down the list of things that the college had sent me, the blankets and sheets and mattress cover and pen and towel and umbrella and all the kind of stuff that you need at college. I wrote down that I needed new tires for my car. I was driving an old 62 Chevrolet with worn out retreads, and I knew it would never make it. On the bottom of the list, in big numbers, I wrote down $500, because that's how much money I needed, and believe me, in those days, that was an awful lot of money. And I took that list to an old guard shack on the backside of Fort Meade, and I fell down on my knees, and I said, God, I believe for 2 years now that you were calling me to be a minister, and I really want to do that, but I can't do it now. I need your help. I said, Lord, I'm going to ask you to meet every need on this piece of paper, every single one, and it's just between us. I'm not going to tell anybody about this. I don't want people feeling sorry for me. I don't want people to be saying, oh, he needs this, I'll give it to him. Lord, it's between us. But if you meet my needs so that I can go to college and be a minister, I will serve you the rest of my life, and if you don't, then I guess I'll find something else. The first thing I needed was acceptance to college by the 15th of December. Let me tell you, friends, God is never late, but he will scare you to death sometimes. The 12th of December, the 13th, the 14th, nothing. The 15th of December, the very last day, I went down to my mailbox in the old combination kind. I stuck my hand in it. I didn't have the guts to look in it. I just did the combination. Put my hand in there, and there was my acceptance to college. And I rushed off to the personnel office and filled out all the forms, and they chewed me out for coming the last day, but I filled it all out. They scheduled me for get out of the Air Force on a Thursday morning, and I still didn't know what God was doing for sure. But Wednesday night, before the Thursday morning, the pastor of the local church that I had been serving in, or just volunteering, teaching Sunday school and stuff, he asked me to say a goodbye Bible study to everybody, just let me be the speaker. And I got up and I taught a little Bible study, and I said, I'm following God's will for my life, whatever that would be. And then I started to sit down. And he said, wait a second, Cecil. He said, a shut-in lady in the church, that is a lady who was bedridden, who belonged to the church, but couldn't come because she was bedridden. She just had this overwhelming feeling that you needed tires for your car. She wasn't sure you even had a car, but she called around to a lot of people and took up an offering. And the doors on the side of the church swung open, and here came deacons rolling 4 brand new tires for my car. And I was stunned. And then he said, Cecil, that's not all. And he reached in his pocket and he pulled out an envelope with $176 in it. And he said, Cecil, they gave too much money. And I began to weep right in front of all of them. And he said, Cecil, that's not all. And he took me to the front of the church, the foyer. And the foyer was filled with gifts. Remember, nobody knew about my list. But there were the sheets, and there was the blankets, and there was the mattress cover. Who gives anybody a mattress cover? But there was the mattress cover. There was the iron, and the pen, and the umbrella. And when I got back to the barracks that night, every single thing on my list was there except the $500. And I got up the next morning, and I had the tires put on the car. I went and I signed out of the Air Force. I went back to the barracks and started loading the stuff. I had several loads of stuff to fill out. The very last load, this is how God works. This is what's so exciting about serving the Lord. The last load. I was walking like this, and a lady came up running from the right. She was a retired telephone operator. I knew her, but I didn't know her very well. I'd only met her twice. She came running from the right, and she was waving something. She said, Cecil, Cecil, I'm glad I caught you. She came up to me, and she said, Cecil, every time I pray, I feel like you need something that was given to me, and I've got to give it to you. So she handed me a cashier's check for $500. Does God answer prayer? You bet your mattress cover God answers prayer. I don't know your circumstances today. I couldn't know. In a group this size, there are probably people with health problems and family problems and marriage problems and problems with your kids or problem with your job or problem with deployment. Some of you are probably despair with the rain and the snow and all those kinds of things. You might feel like God's cell phone is out of order and God's answering machine isn't working and that God's sending nothing but rain and snow into your life. But friends, that's not true. This is not the National Wish Luncheon or the National Hope Luncheon. This is the National Prayer Luncheon. If you will pray, if you will honor God in your life, then God will hear your prayer, God will answer your prayer, and God will send a holy fire that will come directly from his heart to yours, and it will change your life forever. I don't guarantee that. He guarantees that. God bless you and God bless America.
On behalf of the men and women of Team Minot, Colonel Mazinski and Colonel Summers would like to present you with a token of their appreciation.
Captain General Richardson, thank you so much for coming out and sharing your inspirational stories with our men and women. It's been truly an honor to hear your words today. So on behalf of all Team Minot, we present you with a small token of our appreciation.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Ladies and gentlemen, we thank you for attending the 2013 Team Minot National Prayer Luncheon. Please join me in a round of applause for everyone who made today's program successful. Chaplain McGregor, would you please come forward to offer the benediction?
Good and gracious God, we know you by many names and seek you in different ways and in many places. We pray for one another and give thanks for the nourishment of this luncheon, especially for the faith and inspiration of Chaplain Richardson. Guide and guard us on our journeys, however near or far they may be. As we depart, help us to name the blessings we have encountered here and to share those blessings with Minot and with whomever and wherever we live, love, work, and play. Show forth your goodness to all we meet so that they too will want to know you. We ask this in your merciful and holy name. Amen.
Thank you, Chaplain McGregor. Ladies and gentlemen, before you leave today, please check under your chair for a yellow sticker. The person with that card has won the table centerpiece. Thank you, and God bless.